Give me an M.
M.
Give me an A.
A.
Give me a G.
G.
Give me an F.
F.
Give me an E.
E.
Give me an... Screw it, we're at Magfest now.
Yay!
Hi, everybody. Welcome to Monster Vlogs in the past.
And or the future.
Ooh, I'm Charlie.
I'm Haley.
And we had to squeeze this in before we left. We are all packed
up. We are hours from going to the airport at this point in time.
But we are there. If you're watching this, we're there now.
Yes.
Just so you know, there's
magic
like weird,
movie time.
Weird, freaky editing techniques. But yeah, what did we just watch?
We watched The House of Frankenstein.
Incorrect. We watched the best dang monster movie so far.
Since the original? You really think since the original? Counting the originals, this is better.
God, no. This was camp as hell.
This was so much fun. It was like the Guardians of the Galaxy of the Universal Monster movies.
Yeah, if one died off 10 minutes in, but that's beside the point. Don't you dare.
Face.
No, you're
Wait
not.
Wait until after the taping.
Yeah. Yeah, it's like Guardians of the Galaxy if one member died off 10 minutes in.
It felt like almost... It was two separate films.
It really
smushed
was.
Into one.
It really was.
In one very short film. Two very short films into one short film.
Now, this was surprisingly well shot,
yes.
too.
Yes. Oh, the composition was lovely.
Composition was lovely. The lighting and the sets were...
There was simultaneous action. Oh. There was visual storytelling.
Like, this director knew what he was doing.
We were so excited. We've been so deprived. And, like, this director, whoever, I forget his name, but whoever he was, knew his stuff and was prepared to use it.
Oh, yeah. He had sets and, like, set designers and wanted to show them off.
Huge set pieces.
Like, amazing establishing shots. Man.
It looked gorgeous. And it was fun as heck.
Oh yeah, this was the oh, we needed this.
Yes.
We needed this like we need Magfest.
Yes.
Like so much crap. Okay.
So basically
plot.
The plot is following this mad scientist and its hunchbacked assistant, mad scientist played by Boris Karloff.
Oh yeah.
And on the way he meets a cast of wacky characters.
I mean, I was gonna say, like, the plot of the, like, 10 minutes in, I was gonna, like, be like, the plot is all over the place. I cannot follow it. But, because it starts out with him meeting this, like, sideshow, showman guy.
This spook show sort of
this
thing.
This traveling spook
show. Traveling,
Can you lower this a little bit?
It's like a, you ever been to the fair and seen the Spider Woman? It's like that.
Except this guy has Count Dracula's skeleton on display, with the spike still impaled in his chest.
Yep.
And
apparently taking that spike out turns him into John Carradine.
Well, first of all, yay John Carradine playing one of the staples.
Yes, because John Carradine plays it well.
And two, at least he didn't sparkle. That's so... True.
Although, I will say...
So, slight bastardizations of the lore aside.
Yeah.
Like, it was a really amazing depiction of Count Dracula.
Yes.
Far better than the trash that we got with Son of Dracula.
Oh, my goodness.
Sorry, Lon Chaney Jr.
But here's one thing.
You've been upstaged.
Yes, definitely. One thing about the plot, I wouldn't say it took me completely out, but it did sort of bug me, is there's a point in time when there's a police chase. Dracula's in a coach, and he's got a chick in the coach, and he's like, whip the horses along, you know, away from the police who are on horseback in supposedly contemporary times. But, and then, like, there's this part where Dracula is running, and it is so weird to see Dracula running. And even as hokey and dumb as Lon Chaney Jr.'s portrayal of him was, he didn't make sudden movements like that. He didn't, you know, behave... human.
Because he could turn into a bat.
Right.
Like, no, this is the most human depiction we've seen of
and
him.
And it's weird. It's kind of off-putting in the way that... It's like... Because he... Dracula is all about moving slowly and never looking like he's in a hurry because he's got it all figured out. Well, he's already five steps ahead of you.
Unless somebody like flashes him with a mirror or sunlight or whatnot.
Even then, that's like bringing out an animal nature. That's not like, oh no, where is thing? I must run. It's just odd to see. It's not a complete breaking, but it is odd. Like you expect Dracula to act not that impatient.
But
and he was killed off early in the movie
and never came back.
As much as we were hoping.
Sorry, but this is not I forgot. But it was kind of weird, and we should have seen it coming just based on like the hierarchy that was established when he was introduced. Because it was Boris Karloff who removed the stake and said, and he kind of held it in front of him when he reformed.
He had this crap on.
Like Dracula was trying to reinstate.
He was trying to like do the eye thing and like, you will put that stake down. You do not want to sell me death sticks.
Out of here. don't deserve to be in the rest of the video.
That is exactly what happened. It was a death stick.
I refuse. I'm gone. You can do the rest of the video. No, I will not have episode 2 references in my video. No.
But it was a stick of death. It was a wooden stake. It was a stick and it provided death for Dracula.
You scratched me. You drew blood on Monster Vlogs. Are you happy?
Yeah. Sorry.
Not there, but whatever.
I'm getting that zit.
Do not get the... Anyway. Dracula's trying... I love you too. Dracula's trying to reinstate his dominance. And Karloff's like, you know what? You kind of need that to live. So I'll protect it for you. You can do whatever you want. I'll obey you if you obey me. And he's like...
And his character does this a lot.
Fine.
Very manipulative fellow.
Yeah, manipulative to the point where he dies. He literally kills Dracula. Like not even directly kills Dracula.
Like, there is no loyalty in this man at all.
Makes promises left and right that he doesn't keep. I don't even think, what was his motivation anyway?
He wanted to, he had this almost religious reverence for Dr. Frankenstein's work and wanted to continue it and just keep doing the experiments.
But it just seemed like, doesn't even matter though, because the movie was so much fun.
It was fun.
But there are things about this that just need to be questioned. Like, yeah, it was a lot of fun, but, you know, just some of the character motivations didn't make any sense. Like, Dracula showing up and then suddenly not being in the movie was highly questionable. Dracula used to be, like, the top-tier monster.
That point in time where the scientists, like, got one over on Dracula, it's like, okay! They're on their way out.
Yeah, obviously. But... religious reverence for Frankenstein.
In the very beginning, he was like, don't you dare insult the name of Frankenstein in front of me!
Because I used to be Frankenstein's monster.
That was a good Boris Karloff, babe.
Thank you, dear. I shall see you in some...
Don't talk dirty like that.
Title card. Anyway. But, alright, so plot A ends and it involves some honeymooning couple and they're quickly forgotten about.
Of course,
the
moment Dracula wakes up, he's like macking on this married chick and...
That's what he does.
And it wraps up like almost exactly like one of the earlier Dracula sequels you'd expect.
Yeah. Like, if they had fleshed this out into a full...
That would have been an entire thing.
I would have, if this movie were made nowadays, this would have been part one of two.
Yes.
It's like you said, it was two different movies.
If this movie had been made nowadays, they would have brought friggin' Dracula back.
they would have found some contrived way to do it.
Right. Because in the end, he gets burned up by the sun.
No, he just turns back into a skeleton. You think you can ignore me just because you turned into a skeleton?
And then we get Hunchback and Mad Scientist traveling. They meet up with a traveler girl. Save her from a bad situation, and Hunchback falls in love with her. But then they find the body, the frozen once again. Bodies of the Wolfman, Frankenstein's monster. They thaw them out, and Larry's like, "Hi, I'm the snow. I'm
the snowman.
Shut up. I'm the Wolfman. I want to die. Can you help me with that?"
I want to die. Why did you do this? Why did you resurrect me from the tomb that hides the monster? He did it very. His first line of dialogue was so poetic.
Mm-hmm.
Like this writer too. Oh, man.
They gave Lon some good lines. He really did.
And it was also a treat to finally see Lon Chaney Jr. and Boris Karloff without makeup in the same scene playing out a scene.
Just talking to each other.
Just talking to each other.
It's a treat. Such a treat.
Oh, it was so good. Oh. Reference for what you'll see in a few weeks. Don't get the... Anyway... but then he's like spouting off a promise like, "Oh, I'll put you in the body of the frickin' monster because why not?"
Or
you know, just to lift the curse.
Monster or another guy or something.
I think he wanted to put
Well, what he
Chaney's
wanted to
brain.
Do and what he promised to do are completely separate things.
Yeah, so his motivation is like all over the place. He doesn't land on it. Like, he is a perfect mad scientist.
He finally wants to do science, okay?
Yeah.
He wants to do science to all the peoples in all the ways, and not all the ways they want them to. He just wants to science. Just let the man science, okay?
And you know he can do the science because he has his diplomas on full display.
Yes, there's an actual shot. There's like two diplomas up there. Mad science.
From the University of Universal. The Universal University. You.
Quality education.
But then so-and-so, and then, you know, the dancer girl falls for Larry because
he's troubled.
He's damaged.
He's
Ship
so
them.
Troubled. So troubled. But he's such a nice smile.
He does. I mean, if nothing else, he does have a good smile.
You just have man crushes on all the Universal actors, don't you?
Hey, you know, I'm all wanting some... I'm wanting to get some Karloff. I messed that up. I want to get Karloff.
You are bad. Freaking bad.
But lay me out.
Shut up. But you're right, Karloff was a stone cold fox. You ever seen that man in the makeup chair? Woof.
Without a shirt?
Stop it. You artist forearms, I'm telling you.
But, and you know, it wraps up, you know.
And the monster comes to life.
Comes to life. The girl kills the wolf man.
The girl shoots
the wolf man. Like he
shoots him in the gut, bang!
Dead.
Makes a bullet from her own rosary beads.
So that way it's extra holy.
Extra poetic. She shoots him down, but gets killed in the process. Hunchback has had officially enough of this.
Now we have to bleep you.
Sorry. Just made more work for you. But then he almost kills Mad Scientist, mostly dead.
But Monster...
But Monster then chucks him out a window.
Chucks him out a window.
The actor that played the Hunchback is an amazing stuntman. Did some amazing stunt work in this. Very good job.
Like a lot of like acrobatic stuff, like swinging around corners.
And a lot of good pratfalls.
Like falling down that the trap hole.
Mm-hmm.
In the ruins of the castle.
That,
and falling from the roof!
I really hope there was at least a mattress.
Of course there was. Of course they're, they didn't care about animal rights, but they sure as hell cared about keeping their actors alive for the most part.
Well, they had to get them for the next picture. Anyway, and then, like, monster chucks Hunchback out of a window, killing him. Takes mostly dead mad scientist out into the bog, and they sink into the quicksand.
A like the mummy and mummies, ghost, and...
Same set, I believe.
I do think it was the same set, too.
It was a very quick and fun climax.
Quick and fun climax. And this movie had incredible pacing. Like, it did. When I checked the time...
Nice and short and sweet.
When I checked the time, we only had like 20 minutes left. So it is incredibly engaging if you want to check it out. Yes. But one thing that I was thinking, especially toward the end, like watching the whole like final confrontation between Chaney and Karloff, was that this felt like, okay, it did feel like incredibly campy. It was camp as
incredible.
But it was incredibly campy, but it felt, this was the first one that felt like a 50s B movie.
Yes. It was get in there. It felt like right up.
Like the seeds are planted for what we're about to deal
with. It belonged to be inspiring, like young Dracula, young Frankenstein. Dang it.
Well, not even young Frankenstein. Like this movie probably inspired the style that we're gonna see with, you know, well, a brief glimpse at the 50s.
But it was so much fun. I mean, it wasn't even, like, too cheesy, 50... like, when you think of the 50s.
Well, I mean, the 50s kind of had to up the cheese level because they couldn't really deal with, like, have the classic monsters anymore. Because it was the atomic age, yes. And we are
getting there. But these still had some moments of pathos. These still had some moments of, like, oh, I feel for this person. You know, some very poetic moments, and it still had that, and it was still fun. That's why I call it the Guardians of the Galaxy of the Universal Monsters, because it had that fun and it had that pathos.
Like, who cares about any plot contrivances? Just sit down, watch it, and have a good time. Yes. It's a really riffable movie.
Fun time.
This movie is just...
No, might not scare your pants off.
It won't scare you at all.
But you'll enjoy it.
There's a lot of... It's a classic monster movie. There's a reason this one is, like, highly praised.
Very much enjoyed.
Yeah, it's really good.
Yes.
So, didn't draw anything. We were busy eating.
We were packing and eating.
And packing and getting ready for MAGFest. Yeah. If you see us, say hi. I'm probably going to be hanging with... Yeah, you advertise the con that's going to be... By the way, I got that email for Disney Day.
Really?
It is that Sunday.
I knew it!
But we're gonna be there. We're gonna be wearing the same clothes. Obviously, this is going up on Thursday, so you won't see this until the day after we get there. So we'll be roaming around, chatting with friends, filming stuff with peoples, and
going to panels,
hunting down Aaron
and Susie.
And Susie, not Holly, because she's taking care of pigeons. We're a little too obsessed with the Grumps, aren't we?
I just think Susie's cool.
I want to get some of her art painted. You want some bugs around here, don't you? Like the butterflies? Moths?
Butterflies. Not the beetles.
The moths?
Beetles I would accidentally smack.
Spiders.
No!
Calgary. So, horrifying to a 1944 audience? I don't think so.
I think this was the cheesy blockbuster.
This was the Saturday matinee.
Yeah, this was the cheesy blockbuster of that day and age.
Yep, this was the Saturday matinee that, you know, parents just let their kids go see.
Drop the kids off at.
They went to go see more important pictures.
If they saw pictures at all.
Yeah, exactly. They probably went to the opera.
Or the play. Or the actual spook show.
Horrifying now? Nah.
But fun. So much fun.
So much fun.
Yes.
Like, I honestly probably want to show this at a movie night.
Yes. I endorse this.
Like, it is a little sequel-y, but it doesn't matter. Everything is so well reestablished.
And there's no stock footage or recycled footage.
No, there isn't. None of that. Because we had a competent director.
We had a great director that didn't want to rip off anyone else.
Oh, man.
And yet we knew the whole story. We figured it out. It was so good.
All right. Yeah.
If you want to have fun, you can subscribe to our faces.
Well, just click our faces
to subscribe.
Click
our faces to subscribe. You will be subscribed to our faces.
I'm subscribed to her face.
Yeah.
And she's subscribed to my face.
Yeah. And also, comment.
Like, comment.
Go to Patreon.
Become
patron today.
Patrons.
Thank you to our awesome patrons.
Yay, all of them. They're in the corner over there somewhere.
Last week we saw the mummy's ghost. Next time, what's next time?
Doing the mummy's curse.
Not mummy's curse. Is that the last mummy movie?
It is the last
freaking mummy movie. You better come here for that. Closing the door on another monster. Closing the casket, as it were.
I think
the sarcophagus.
Well, we still got a couple more like Frankenstein monster movies. We got Abbott and Costello Meet Frankenstein coming up, which is like the last great monster mash. This was a culmination of like Frankenstein meets the Wolfman. So,
which was really the culmination of the Frankenstein storyline.
This is just
everything is extra canonical.
This is just fun for the sake of fun because all their boys were out and fighting Nazis and fighting Japanese and Italians, if they were involved at all. I don't really know. I mean, Mussolini's kind of just in the ledgers, like, okay, he was involved.
Yeah, I love the Italian response to fascism. Was like,
Baba da boo da ba!
That was rude. Good night, everybody.
Good night. See you at Magfest.
Let's get on a plane!
Okay, you can pop my zit now.
Thank you.
Ow! Ow!
I'm getting it. Don't squirm. Alright.
Ow! Stop it.
I got it. Okay?